Good afternoon. Welcome to our panel on advancing accessibility in smart destinations. My name is Marina Diotallevi from the UNWTO. I'm the head of ethics, culture, and social responsibility. Before I start, I will have to excuse some of the panelists who didn't make it. Unfortunately, due to bad weather, we have Mr. Sergio Fonseca from Samsung, who could not join us today, and also Mr. Manel Alcaide from Visual Fi, but although he cannot be here with us this afternoon, he sent a video that we are going to see at the end from the three presentations. So before I introduce our three colleagues and speakers this afternoon, I would like to make a small presentation of the context in which we are going to discuss this accessibility panel. This panel about accessibility for all, it's focused mostly into accessibility in terms of inclusion. Inclusion of persons who have the right to enjoy leisure, sport, travel and tourism at the same conditions as everybody else. I would like to remind that overall, globally in the world, we have 15% of the world population who has some forms of disability. This represents around 1 billion people. These persons encounter serious obstacles and barriers to access information, facilities, products and services at the destination. To this, we will have to consider and add the rapidly aging population, mostly in industrialized countries. It is estimated that by 2050, around 20% of the world population will be over 60 years of age. This means that an increase in the rate of access requirements and access services are requested at destination level. So it's a huge segment of the population which have access requirements and represents also a huge market for tourism. So this is why accessibility is not only a must for an inclusive tourism development, it is also an enormous business opportunity as it improves the quality, the sustainability and the competitiveness of a destination and increases visitor and local satisfaction. And overall, it benefits all the society and the population. So during this smart talk, we will hear the experiences from destinations. We will hear about needs and challenges of persons with disability and the seniors. And also we'll see and hear about smart solutions by entrepreneurs. Now I will introduce the speakers one by one according to the order of intervention. We will start by the presentations concerning smart destination, accessible destinations. We will start with Mr. Olaf Schlieper. Mr. Schlieper is Innovations Manager at the German National Tourist Board. He is responsible for sustainability strategy and the creation of sustainable and barrier-free products. He is also responsible for international promotion of Germany as a sustainable destination and for the organization of the Barrier-Free Tourism Day at ITB Tourism Fair. Mr. Schlieper will be our first panelist. He will be followed by Mr. Daniel Tsunegi, who is the head of international relations at Red Estable. Red Estable is a Spanish network for accessible tourism. Mr. Tsunegi has been working in the hospitality sector for 14 years And he's also currently the co-founder and managing director of Accessible Spain Travel, specialized in incoming travel agency to Spain, catering for travelers with accessibility needs. He is at the same time representing Rete Stable at this panel. And Rete Stable has developed the self-diagnosis and accessible tourism promotion platform, Spain is Accessible. We will hear more about this immediately. Then it will be the turn of Mr. Roberto Torrena Cristobal, who is the director of the Digital Experience Transformation and Innovation Department at Illunion Technology and Accessibility, which is the technology and consultancy company belonging to the business group ONCE, which is the National Organization for the Blind. Mr. Torrena has 10 years experience in the company and has led national, international mobile and web applications development and R&D and innovative initiatives. All of them designed with accessibility and designed for all criteria. So these are the three panelists which are present, that are present today. The last one who could not be attending, unfortunately, but has sent in this afternoon a video that we are going to see after the presentation of the three panelists, is Mr. Manel Alcaide, who is the CEO of Visualfy. Mr. Alcaide is an entrepreneur with more than 16 years business management experience in sectors related to performing arts and new technology. He is specialized in developing projects directed to people with differential capabilities with the aim of achieving a more egalitarian future for everybody. His application, his solution is focused on persons with hearing impairment. So we will start with the presentation by Mr. Olaf Schlieper. Please, Mr. Olaf, please.
Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction, and hello to you all, and thank you very much for the opportunity to present Destination Germany and its activities according to barrier-free tourism. Let me just show a short agenda. It's not a long presentation. I just want to show you a short introduction, a film about our activities. And then I brought to you a showcase about a quite new national information system, which is called Tourism for All. But first, let's start with the cinema part. But we need sound.
Accessibility plays an important role in this. The GNTB and its partners are reaching out not only to people with disabilities, but also to families with children, older holiday makers, and those traveling for health reasons. That's more than 140 million people in the European Union alone. And they're doing so successfully. Germany already has a well-connected transport network and plenty of accessible accommodation, restaurants, and attractions. Guided tours are adapted to the needs of a wide range of disabilities, and Germany's national parks and nature parks offer many barrier-free experiences. The GMTV showcases the variety and credibility of these offerings through various activities. These include the Germany Travel Mart, the largest inbound tourism workshop for Destination Germany, where buyers from around the world can get an overview of the German market. Together with its partners, the GNTB has successfully staged the Barrier-Free Tourism Day at the ITB, the world's largest travel trade show, for several years now. The GNTB also promotes Germany as a barrier-free travel destination through its numerous representative offices abroad. Consumers, journalists, tour operators, and other key players are kept up to date with the accessible tourism market in Germany at events and workshops and via the GNTB's online channels. The GNTB actively supports the Reisen für alle, Travel for All, National Certification Scheme in order to develop and promote barrier-free tourism, so that more and more people can enjoy accessible and hassle-free holidays in destination Germany.
So now I would like to give you a more detailed information about this Travel for All information system. And by the way, I have printed information about it. So if you would like to have one, just talk to me after the panel discussion. Travel for All is aiming a central idea to have a consistent quality and consistent labeling, a nationwide information system about accessible tourism projects. So it should cover all Germany. You may know that we don't have a national tourism organization in Germany focusing on projects within Germany. Tourism is on the shoulders of our 16 federal states. So it's not a national task, it's a task of the 16 federal states. And each of these states had a different approach to check the accessibility of tourism products. They had different certification systems and different labels and logo, different wordings. And so the idea was to put it all together and to create one professional, reliable information system for the whole nation. And this is now ready to use, and it is in use in Germany. So the idea is to really check the accessibility of tourism products, hotels and others, and then promote it even online on different platforms using the same system, a quite sophisticated and in-depth system for the whole nation. We have many, many project partners, which was really necessary to make the system fitting right to the needs of people with accessibility needs. So it really should fit to the handicapped persons. And on the other hand, it must be handled by the tourism trade and the tourism partners. So they had all been invited by the Federal Ministry of Economic Affairs and Energy. They paid for the whole project, the initiating of the project. And for several years, all the major stakeholders in German tourism sat on the same table and talked about this product and pulled the same rope in the same direction to get a good result, you know. So we have transport companies, these are only examples. We have hotel chains, we have regional destination marketing and management organizations, the National Tourist Board, and many other associations, and the major association for handicapped people. So the National Blind People Organization, handling the accessibility needs of wheelchair users, of deaf people, etc. And now in all Germany, trained staff is walking around and really checking the spots according to their accessibility for these mentioned target groups. So mobility impaired persons, deaf persons, people with visual impairments, and also people with cognitive impairments. And this is how it goes. Here we have the assessment at the spot. So the people go around with laptops and type in all the details in how far a train station or a hotel is accessible. The detail will directly go to a database. Then we have a quality check by a national tourism organization. And from then, the information is sent to all the 16 federal states and their websites, and maybe some regional websites as well. It is, starting this year, sent to the German National Tourist Board's website, so we have an overview of all these assessed tourism projects through all Germany in German and English. And of course, it is possible to send it to third parties who are interested, hotel platforms or car association, whatever. And the database will be ready in June. We're now working with the interim database, but the real one will be accessible in June, and we will roll out in, until October, because in October, you may know, there is the World Conference for Destinations for All in Brussels, from the 1st to the 2nd of October, and this is the place to be for us. We are also gold sponsors, and we will showcase this project. So what is checked, it's everything along the travel chain. So it's accommodation, restaurants, it's sites, tourist information, even airports, huge entities, train stations, and hiking routes and cycling routes. We now have certifications even of long distance hiking routes, so that you really know about the accessibility of the road itself, about the hotels around, the restaurants and the train station, etc. No? A lot of work, but now it's ready. And the newest development is that we check whole tourism regions. So in former times, you just checked single entities like hotels, and now whole tourism regions get under certification. They do the assessment, and handicapped people can be sure that each part of the travel chain has been thought of, and so they can have reliable and very deep information on these regions. The hotels and all the others get a certification. They can use it for marketing. They can use special logos. But the major part is the client, and you can use the database and do texture search, or even click on what he really needs, and then he gets these kind of results. And let's say Novotel Hamburg, and if you click there, you get very detailed information. Sorry, this is German, but it will be also available in English, with the in-depth information, how many centimeters the doors have, how the showers are, and how far the hotel is ready for blind people. So very detailed information. And we talked to the handicapped person, and they said in how deep, how they advised us about the depth of information they really need to create trust. So it should be digital, but reliable. So we don't want hotel owners to say, well, I'm ready for handicapped persons. That's not the way. But we decided, you really train staff to go to the hotel and check everything. And it's not only about checking, it's also about training. Every hotel and all the entities, they have to undergo a training. The management, as well as the counter staff, has to do a personal training and an online training. It's a fixed part of the assessment. So I think that's enough for an introduction, and thank you very much.
Right, thank you very much, Olaf. And now I would like to call Daniel to make his presentation also about the destination Spain, accessible destination Spain. Please, Daniel.
Thank you, Marina. I would like to thank first the organizing committee, everyone involved in this event. We are very honored to be here. It's great to share space on this panel with such high-level professionals and industry leaders. I'm here today representing our association. Red Estable is composed of more than 120 organizations in Spain working for accessible tourism. And I'm here representing all of them, and our president, Diego González. And I will be first introducing briefly our organization. After that, I will be explaining some of the projects that some of our members have undertaken recently. And finally, I will be explaining into more detail the IPAL technology, which we believe is very relevant for today's topic, which is advancing accessibility in smart destinations. So who we are, what's Red Estable? We're a network. It's composed of, as I said, more than 120 companies that are directly or indirectly involved in accessible tourism. We are very diverse, and we include from hotels, restaurants, specialized travel agencies, tour operators, architects, engineers. We believe that a network has a great strength, in especially connecting, especially in the travel industry. We believe that the tourist industry has a great need in terms of connecting such diverse type of stakeholders, and we think this allows us to work towards our same goal, because we share one goal in Red Estable, and that is making a more inclusive sector. I will be explaining some of the projects that I hope you find interesting. I will be explaining the EPAT technology, which was been recently awarded by ITH, the Institute for the Hospitality Institute Technological in Spain, as the award for accessibility in smart destinations. And I'll also explain you some other projects by some other of our members. Another one is Chef Voice. Chef Voice is a voice assisted restaurant menu. This helps basically anyone, and that's what makes it interesting. It is possible to showcase it in a language. It is, of course, mainly focused for persons with reduced or visual impairment or with difficulties to read, but it actually helps everyone, and I think that's what makes it interesting when we speak about accessibility. I'm sure you all know the advantages of approach and manage accessibility. From a universal accessibility perspective, we can develop different applications that not necessarily have to be focused on persons with disabilities, but which actually help everyone. And I found this particular example interesting. Something like restaurants, of course, like here there's many people from many countries, and this can apply to anyone. We all have restaurants. Each restaurant have menus, and a simple application with a smartphone and a QR code makes people capable to hear the menu, and for any other person has the possibility to visualize and find great information about, for example, recommendations. Owners can update its menu. So this is an example of in my opinion, a great it's a good example of innovation and technology coming together towards accessibility and towards a solution that helps everyone, both with travelers and citizens, right? We spoke about this today. I Say Hotel is an example of an online platform that helps basically suppliers, any organization providing lodging in the travel industry. So what happens is many hotel owners don't actually know their level of energy efficiency, accessibility. So it's a great example from another of our members, ITH. They're providing a tool for owners to know their level of accessibility. I will speak about that a bit later. MDQ is developing audio and video guides on sign language. This is a great tool for museums, monuments. Again, it helps everyone coming to a museum instead of just using an audio guide. It could be an audio and video guide on sign language. And this has been developed within different monuments and museums in Spain. Amphon has developed also an audio induction loop system, which most of you should will probably know. These are induction loop systems that help people with hearing impairment and hearing difficulties hear, actually. And they have developed it in a large scale, and this is also quite relevant. In this case, for the Santander bank offices. Now I go back to the IPAD technology. This is the most relevant case and example that I wanted to be explaining today. The IPAD comes as a solution for travel destinations, public organizations wanting to promote their destination. Could be Oviedo promoting itself and auditing and finding out their level of accessibility. Could be a region, could be a country, wanting to know first how is their accessibility, what's their degree, are they doing good, are they doing bad, where can they improve, and what are doing terribly wrong. So this is a great tool. I think it was really relevant. It is for any travel or any destination wanting to first know if it can be promoted as an accessible travel destination for all. Secondly, it can promote the communication between travelers and travel services. And this helps transmitting confidence for travelers. As you know, having a disability sometimes makes it very difficult. As Marina has said previously, there is a lack of information. So having a platform where you can consult and you can be informed of how is the destination or what's the destination offering, it's a great help. It's a great help for travelers, and that provides confidence and security. And as I said, it provides a tool for travel destinations to know their degree of accessibility. The platform comes in two main different parts. One is the audits platform. Because of course, we have to audit, we have to know how are the resources. So IPAD comes from an advanced and developed system that actually has been in use for many years as a PAT resource protocols for auditing accessibility. So what they've used, what they've done is developing from a technological point of view this let's say physical way of auditing. The second part is focused on promoting and marketing your destination as an accessible destination. And that includes the development of a website and a mobile application. This is how this technology looks like for a recent project, Spain is Accessible. It was, as you see, it was So it was basically focused on promoting Spain as an accessible destination, which was, it is still very needed. And so it was a great effort on auditing the many resources. As you see on your left, the administration platform for owners. This is what you can see as an administration platform for owners. What is interesting here is that either the services can be audited externally or could be audited by the same owner. I will show you that a bit later. And that comes as a first step of having a very developed platform, which is the PAT platform, that diagnoses the accessibility in a very precise way. This process is also standardized, which is very important because you end up having your destination with a standardized and homogenized way of communicating and auditing accessibility. And that makes a lot of what is veracity. This data basically connects automatically with the website and the mobile application. So within one same system, you're working both on your data of your destination related to accessibility and on the promotion and marketing of these services. This platform also allows to generate an accessibility statement, which is very useful for many suppliers that want to know and want to have, a statement, a document that they can use to communicate. It could be on their hotel sites, it could be on their marketing and promotional material. And on your right side, you can see both the website and the mobile application. As you see, the website is both and the mobile application is developed under AAA accessibility standards. What's interesting is the platform can be filtered by service and accessibility need. This is something you can see here. So someone with, let's say, hearing impairment can actually filter and find services based on her accessibility need, and also by destination or by type of service. The apps provide, as you know, it's a great tool for immediacy. The PPAD technology provides GPS and also the possibility to add reviews, which helps a lot, as you know, in the travel industry. And it's both available in Android and Apple. This is how the administration panel looks like. This is how the website, as I say, is AAA, accessible for all. And all in all, it's a great tool as a first step for travel destinations in order to make an overview and see how they're doing in terms of accessibility and promoting and communicating all this information. I hope this has been interesting anyway. Thank you for attention.
Thank you, Daniel. Before I give the floor to our next speaker, who is going to talk about a solution, I would like to summarize briefly the two presentations concerning accessibility at the destination, or accessible destination, smart destination. Some very important concepts have been mentioned, both by Olaf and by Daniel. The importance of, obviously, coordinating and networking and working with all the stakeholders, both the public and private sector, and especially with the disabled people's organizations, it's essential. But it's also essential to unify at national level all the systems, accessibility certification systems, so as not to create confusion for the tourist, for the foreign tourist that comes from abroad. One important issue was mentioned by Olaf, which is training of the staff that is welcoming the persons with access needs. It is important that the staff and the managers, as you mentioned, know, understand, and address the needs, all the needs of a customer with disability. So it's really important that the customer feels themselves welcome, that they are treated with courtesy and efficiency, and that all the necessary information and complete information are provided to them by the staff. Another important concept that was mentioned by Daniel is the promotion and the marketing. Here it is important, UNWTO has been working on accessibility for many years, and we have launched and published several recommendations and published several technical manuals. In terms of marketing and promotion, what we have seen by experts is that the offer of accessible tourism and the offer specifically address for persons with disabilities or the seniors should be incorporated in the general marketing of the destination and of the offerings of the destination. It shouldn't be separate. It should be part of the general marketing strategy and promotion strategy of the destination. So it's what we at least recommend. Now, I'm pleased to give the floor, open up for the solutions that are being proposed, first by Ilunion, by Roberto Torena, and later on by Vision Fly, Manel Alcaide, who has sent us the video. So, Roberto, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. First of all, I want to make you a question. How many of you know or have seen a blind person using a mobile? Please raise your hand. One, two, not many, okay. Can a blind person use a mobile? Let's start by the very beginning. Okay, let me show you something. Okay, this is voiceover.
Videos, wallet, reminders, iTunes Store, health, home, FaceTime, extras folder, six apps. Action, voiceover off.
This is how a blind person uses a mobile. Okay, this voice is already in the mobile. You don't need to create anything special. Okay, you only need to create things that are compatible with this system. This voiceover, people that cannot move their arms use another system, but all of them can be compatible with any system that you design. So you only need to be sure that your system is compatible with this. You don't need to be anything complex. Okay, it's very easy. What I'm going to show you right now is one application that is not design it for people with disabilities. Let me be very specific. It's designed for everyone. We don't design solutions for people with disabilities. We design solutions that interest everyone and that can be used also for people with disabilities. Okay. I'm gonna skip this very fast. This is the hardware part. Okay, the solution is going to be implemented in museums and exhibition centers. And we need some devices that are called beacons. It's our brand, but they are eye beacons that sends a signal in Bluetooth low energy that have a short range of 15 to 30 meters, which means that when your mobile detects this device, it means that you are in a specific room of the museum or of the exhibition center. So we can know where the visitors that are using this app are around the museum. Okay. What are we going to use this? We are going to use this to create an application that will make the museums more multimedia, interactive, and inclusive for everyone. It doesn't mind if you are an expert and you are looking for learning something new, or you are a family with children that are looking for different things, games or something more funny, or if you have a disability or not, okay? The general idea is to provide something that can be useful for everyone. It's a single platform, which means that the museum doesn't need to create their own application. There is a single application, only one, and each museum can update all the information, can update the content, the ideas, the games or whatever, even the look and feel. And when someone goes to this application to a specific museum, only the information of this museum is available there. This is also relevant because of the artist rights. Usually the museum have paid for the rights to present something in a specific location. If they want to bring it to the internet, they have to pay a different rights. So this is a way to establish that the information is only active when the person is inside the museum, and also it's a way to attract people to the museums. Okay, right now it's already deployed in one museum on one exhibition, and we have just started, so along the following months I hope you will see it in many museums around Spain. The general idea is that the museums can upload all the information that they have. If they have polytextual information, they can upload it. If they have videos, they can upload it. If they have some specific characteristics, features, functions that are demanded by people with disabilities, for example, audio description videos for people with blindness, or sign language videos for people with deafness, they can upload it, okay? Most of the times when some museums do this sort of initiatives, people with disabilities doesn't know it, so they don't ask for it. So in this application, here you can see that there are some icons to specifically tell the person some information about the accessibility of this specific route. Okay, you can create several routes for several purposes, for the topic that of the museum, or for the time that the person is going to have to make this route. Here you can see a route of 45 minutes, another of 20 minutes. Depending on the characteristics on the facilities that you have for people with disabilities, it will be also make available for them through these icons. Okay, if it's accessible for wheelchair users, one of the routes, it's also established by a specific icon. And let me. Okay. Keep. On the right side, you have the information of a specific element. You can establish information by element or by the specific room. It depends on what do you want to do with this information of the museum. And we take advantage that we know where the user is in order to give them some warning in case they are reading the information of a specific step of step five, but the user is still in the first room. So we can give them this warning and say, okay, you are in the wrong place or reading the wrong things. If you want, we can give you the right information that is another one, okay? And we can provide the specific information for the specific room in which the user is at that moment. Also, thanks to this location system, we can provide a map to the user and establish where he or she is. So if there is a very big museum and he's a bit lost, he can, you know where he is and where he needs to go. We have also entered some artificial intelligence tools through automatic image recognition because sometimes we want this to be very interactive, and finding information of a specific element that you have in front of you can be as complex as, okay, let's go to the room, let's go to the element, click in the element, or just aim this element with your camera. As simple as that. You just aim the element to the camera and automatically all the information is provided. So it's more easy to access. Another interesting feature is that right now in all the systems, especially in touristic environments, we want to provide comments, and this is no different. Users will be able to provide comments on the specific elements that are shown or on a specific route whenever the museum wants. Some museums doesn't want it because they are afraid of what people can say, but other museums want it, so the platform is make it available for those museums that want it. This is more or less what is our current audio guide, but with additional features, but we wanted to go beyond that. So let's make it a bit more amuse. That's why this is called amuse. And we enter some gamification techniques in which people going around all these museums can collect masters and tools, depending on which museum you will have one or another. When you enter in the museum, you will have a tip telling you where you can find this master or tool. And when you reach this room, the system automatically sends you a test. This test can be a question that you can answer with the information that is around you. Or you can make also a test that requires that the visitor aims some element in the museum with the camera, for example, to make it more interactive. In this case, obviously for people with blindness, there is an alternative that is a question always, because the whole tool has to be accessible for everyone. And if you have the enough points and pass all the tests, you start collecting all these masters and tools from museum to museum. This is the face for the user, but what is the front office for the museum manager? Most of the museum managers, from time to time, develop an application that sometimes is accessible, most of the times it's not, and then it is finished and it's there forever. And this is not very useful because you are changing the information, and you need to change the elements that you are showing. You want, in this case, to change the games and everything. So what is behind this system is a web in which you can manage all the functionalities in your museum. What are the routes? What are the elements? What is the information you can upload? New accessible measures that you have improved, or you can change the game. You can do whatever through our site. So you don't need any programmer to keep it updated forever. This is an easy and useful way. So we invite, if any of you is responsible of a museum, to make your museum more interactive and inclusive for everyone.
Thank you, Roberto. I would just highlight of your tool and your solution, the importance that you said that it's a solution for everyone. It's the solution that makes life easier for everybody, for the people with disabilities and all of us. So thank you very much, Roberto. Now I'd like to give the, well, put the project the video by Manel from Visual Fly. Thank you.
Y soy cofundador de VisualFi. Lo primero, pediros disculpas por no poder estar aquí esta tarde con vosotros.
Good afternoon, my name is Manel, and I'm the owner of VisualFi. I apologize for not being able to see you. It's a startup created by people that are blind and deaf, that through our system enables them to. Well, there are different types of communication systems that adapt differently to different people that are deaf. When we think of someone deaf, we think of someone using sign language. However, among us, we have a lot of people that are also deaf that we can identify easily. Aid systems and cochlear implants are increasingly more sophisticated and revolutionizing deaf this field. At present, according to the World Health Organization, there are more than 40 to 60 million with hearing impairment. And one third of the population over 65 years old has descending hearing. This is also impacting people between 20 and 35 years because of their misuse of headphones. So we have hearing impairment issues coming up at an earlier age. So as I was saying, a third of the population over 65 years old has disabling hearing loss. And we also leading longer lives. So in a scenario where we estimate that by 2050, the number of people with hearing loss will be about 1 billion. Given this situation, we should raise awareness in the industry to invest in this target, which is increasing every day. Today, there are a lot of awareness with architectural barriers. Most new buildings have accessibility, ramps, braille, lifts, adapted bathrooms, and so on. That's great. But what about people that have hearing loss? It's an invisible disability. It means that we're not covering their needs. This means that a customer that pays the same as any other customer cannot enjoy the same experience like another person. Accessibility is not just for disabilities. For disabled people, we all know the importance that user experience has in tourism. And that's what accessibility is all about, ensuring that any user can improve the experience with that particular brand, regardless of any disability that an individual might have. Most of you are probably thinking, have we ever had a deaf customer visit us? Well, the thing is that deaf is invisible and it's stigmatized. So people don't really hide the fact that they are deaf, which is erroneously attributed to misunderstanding and so on. So it means that we don't really know the customers with hearing loss that come across our facilities. And this kind of solution will be very good to improve their experience with a particular brand. We need to understand that or know that our sight loss is something that's perfectly normalized. It's okay if you're wearing glasses, but if you're wearing a hearing aid, you're disabled, instantly disabled person. This means that a lot of people try to hide the fact that they're deaf. And in fact, the real numbers are probably higher than that published by the World Health Organization. But times are changing, and we need to be prepared for that. As we know, that people with hearing loss are coming out of the closet. Now, for example, people that wear glasses, it's very fashionable, whereas it used to be people with glasses wasn't fashionable at all. And I think very soon the same thing is going to happen with hearing aid and cochlear implants. with the improved technological improvements, and better connected. But the fact that they're wearing the system doesn't mean that they can hear better. It does help them to communicate better. But once you get to the house or the hotel, you need to disconnect your implant or your hearing aid to charge it. Or, for example, or even just to take a shower or to enjoy silence. So they continue. They need other assistance, other aid. And this is what Visualify helps them with. Visualify is a technology aimed at helping visual and sensorial space in a private space, as well as public spaces. It improves the quality of life, the independence, and the user experience of deaf people or people with hearing loss. We have a few solutions, such as Visualify Home, a system that can alert you of any noise that takes place in the house. For example, it sends a note, a warning to either television, your smartphone, or anything that's connected. But today I want to talk about Visualify Places, technology created to improve experience of people that experience hearing loss in a hotel. The system ensures the experience of the user within the hotel, an enhanced experience. It enriches also the corporate social responsibility of the brand, and it opens the doors to a new target, people with or hearing loss. We have different types of accessibility packages. The first one is technological solutions. Through devices located in the room, it alerts the user that someone's calling, it tells them that the baby's crying, or that the fire alarm is off. This system is also complemented with a panic button, as requested by the law, which is given to them when they arrive at the hotel, so they can alert the lobby on any situation of anything happening in the room. And the lobby can also report back to the user to let them know that help is on its way. They can also have, for example, call for a taxi, or alarm clock service, interpreter service. And this is completed with a beacon in the hotel, which informs to any, not just the hotel guests, but also to anyone going past the hotel, that this hotel is friendly for people with hearing loss. We can take it even further. There's another solution that helps in communication that has accessible content in sign language, subtitles, and audio, which improve significantly the experience at the hotel, not just for deaf people, but also for anyone in the hotel. We also come up with new e-beacons that can be located next to the restaurant or leisure points to promote our services to any visitor. With accessible content in three ways, either through audio, sign language, or subtitles, or video, and also magnetic loops that enable the users with cochlear implants. We can also use another system to enable them to have LEC, interpreters, call center, was created by the Spanish Confederation of Deaf People, and through a video conference gives video interpretation in real time. The service is serviced by deaf people and by specialized certified interpreters. All our services include free access to an e-learning platform where employees can learn the basic guidelines for all the employees and how to handle guests with hearing loss. We also have other consulting services on European financing available. Visualify is committed to technology for all. Access to internet and technology in general has changed our lives. But the question is, to everyone, I think it's time that companies now address the issue. Not just because European recommendations are aimed at this and very soon will become a directive, but it's also our responsibility to offer products and services that are designed for all people, will be more accessible, but will be also be better companies for all and visible to all. Thank you very much.
This solution that Visualify offers us, I think, is very interesting And so I would like to know, does anyone have any questions for our speakers, for our panelists? Again, if a microphone is not used, we cannot translate. Please be sure that you hold it up to your mouth. A few months ago in Córdoba, in the city, there were some people who are poorly sighted. The important thing of this experience is the fact that we have gone through another system, not just the private system, which is working through civil society, through training, and the people who have developed this is a non-profit organization. This has worked out very well with very high social yield, because one of our aims was inclusion. So having worked through an NGO, has enabled us to receive the approval of the municipality. And I think it was a gentleman from Granada, if I'm not mistaken, who is proposing this, not only in Spain, but all over Europe. Excuse me, can you identify yourself? Former civil servant, currently living in Córdoba. So this was not a question, it was an observation. An observation. But my question is, how do you plan to deploy your systems on the market, in the marketplace?
What is called barriers, we know them for a long time ago. The first hardware that we have shown you, in which is a music based, is called BitPons. It was before Odd Barriers. It's our competence in this sense. both systems are pretty similar. Ours is patented, and ours is also deployed in plenty places here in Madrid and many places. We belong to the Spanish Organization of Blind People, so I mean, our focus is also social, and our enterprise is a special employment center. Our business group gives employment for 10,000 people with disabilities, and the business and all ONCE group, I don't know the number, but it's a large amount. I mean, our focus is also social. This is a specific deployment, a specific hardware-based solution that is focus it on people with blindness. We have also plenty of them, but the solution that I presented here is just built on top of that, so we can provide a solution for everyone. That's our focus right now, okay? We can provide the other solution more specifically for people with blindness, but we think that in order to promote it and make private organizations to be interested in it, we have to go further and provide a solution that might bring more clients to them, not only people with blindness. So we are developing these solutions on top, taking advantage on a solution specifically designed for blind people, but providing added value for everyone.
Any other questions? I would like, in this case, just to ask one quick question addressed to all of you, of our speakers. In order to make a smart destination, a destination truly accessible, what needs to change most urgently? Are these the norms, the standards, regulation, investment, better understanding? What is your opinion on that?
Well, I think there is different areas that have to be improved. I think one of them is related with educating the sector. It happens in my case, and when I personally I run an online travel agency specialized in accessible tourism, And it happens to me that it's not a problem of our awareness. It seems like awareness is not the main issue, not as much as knowing what and understanding people, basically. On the previous talk, someone said, understanding people is the first, and then we'll have to understand technology. So, words by the professor Massimo Marchiori, which I totally agree. And in terms of accessibility, I think it's really the case. Understanding ourselves in a, as we are very diverse, and we may or we may not have accessibility needs. Could be dietary requirements, but understanding people. So we can call it awareness. We can call it education, empathy. But the paradigm in that way, in my opinion, has to. It's one of the areas that, in my opinion, we have to work on.
Yes, I can underline this empathy and the open-hearted welcome to people with some kind of handicap. That is really a key issue next to technical stuff. But the field of tourism partners who have still to be convinced is quite wide, you know. We urgently need data to prove also the economic issue, you know, that some are already convinced, but we could have more information on that to provide it to the tourism partners, and thinking along the tourism supply chain, this is a huge challenge, you know. We have single entities already barrier-free, but to work together and to promote them together and to welcome the handicapped guests together, it's still a task, you know.
Roberto? Building on your comments, if any of you is interested, ONCE Foundation published an interesting study on tourism in Spain, okay? Because, yes, one of the main things that we have to do is make the private organizations aware that there is a business here, okay? So this study were focused on what is the willingness to pay of people with disabilities, how many travels they are willing to do, and so on, and so on, and so on. And putting all these numbers together and showing it makes a real proof of this is a real market, and you have to do it in order not to lose this opportunity in the market.
All right, thank you very much. So in concluding, I would just like to mention three points that were presented today. Lastly, what Olaf said, the importance of the accessibility chain in tourism. All the elements of the tourism chain should be accessible, starting from the information, access to information, accessible accommodation, accessible local transportation, accessible leisure and visits. The accessibility chain has to be accessible at all the links. This is really important. We have heard and we have seen that also smart destinations more and more are developing tourism practices that take into account the diversity of the human condition. So in terms of age, mobility, sensory and intellectual impairment, so it's good news. But we still have to encourage and insist other destinations to follow suit. And finally, with a careful approach which combines socially inclusive policies, new technologies and digital information tools, without forgetting the universal design techniques that unfortunately we didn't mention it during the panel, but are extremely important, universal design principles and techniques, destination managers and tourism providers will be able to cater effectively to all tourists and all visitors. So this was more or less the conclusions of today's panel on accessible destinations, smart destinations. I've been asked before I close the panel to remind all participants that tomorrow morning the proceedings, the meetings will start at 9 o'clock sharp. So please, those who are here will be here tomorrow at 9 o'clock, we'll start again with the remaining panels. So with this, I thank you very much. I thank the three panelists, excellent panelists, and all the participants and the audience who has taken the time to stay until the end. Thank you very much. Bye.